our audience has any questions. So our special guest panelist today, Cheryl Bonacci, welcome. Drove all the way out from Los Angeles. She's the Director of Communications for the Anti-Recidivism Coalition. In her capacity working for that organization, she works with adult and juvenile corrections and judicial representatives, Los Angeles County supervisors, and a wide range of community and faith-based organizations that allow her to address the issues from all angles and work together collaboratively towards solutions. She's on the permanent steering committee of the Office of Diversion and Reentry and is a board member for Jesuit Restorative Justice Initiative and the Adbot Project. So thank you for coming. Next we have Professor Annie Buckley. She's in the art department at Cal State San Bernardino. Annie is an artist, writer, curator, and educator with an emphasis on art and social justice. She is an associate professor of visual studies at Cal State San Bernardino and is the founding director of community-based art and more specifically the Prison Arts Collective, which we see the results in here, a project that is funded by Arts and Corrections, the California Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation, and the National Endowment for the Arts. She's curated multiple exhibitions, authored many reviews and essays on contemporary art, and is a contributing editor to the Los Angeles Review of Books. And then next to me here, Heather Roessler is a third-year graduate student and an MFA candidate at Cal State San Bernardino. She has been involved with the Prison Arts Collective for over 3 years and has personal interest in art as therapy. She teaches at which facility?
CIM.
So the facility in Chino, the men's facility. As an artist, Heather works through her own existential struggles with traumatic childhood and life experiences and personal confrontations with death, while searching for her own sense of spirituality in the process. For Heather, art is a healthy coping mechanism and helps her to recognize the healing power of making and self-expression and to share that with others. So, welcome. Thank you for all of the work that you do and thank you for coming all the way out here to be with us. So, I thought maybe we could start by start with you, Annie. I wonder if you could talk a little bit about how and why you started the Prison Arts Collective.
Sure. So, hi. As a professor at Cal State San Bernardino, when I first started, I really wanted to create opportunities for students to facilitate art in the community so that they could put into practice some of the ideas that we were talking about in terms of access to art and who has access to the arts. And so that very quickly grew into a really expansive project for not only students but alumni who wanted to stay with us and volunteer. And one of our first partners was the men's prison in Chino. And then shortly after, I would say about two, not shortly, but about 2 years after that, we started being also funded by Arts and Corrections. And at this point, we're facilitating weekly programs in four prisons and then facilitator training projects in three prisons where they're learning to teach their own classes. And so basically, it really grew a lot because of the need for the arts in our correctional institutions, but also I think because of our population of our students and our alumni who are the teaching artists, like Sisters Heather, about 20 to 30 others over the years, who are so dedicated to it, and also because of the men and women we work with inside are so responsive to the programming and our method of really trying to integrate them and their ideas into what we're doing and how we're working so that it becomes all of our programs. There and they're helping us. It's growing because of all of us.
Mm-hmm. That's great. And did the community-based art program exist prior to the prison arts program?
They all kind of started organically through my service learning class that I started at Kelsey San Bernardino. And I started with the art department shortly after I got there, and it just blossomed into so much that we were like, oh, it just sort of became called community-based art because of that actually descriptor more than anything else. And then the Prison Arts Collective also evolved such that our first exhibition, which was at CB1 Gallery 2 years ago, had about 100 artists, and we were like, well, we want to give a name for the artists, and so we essentially used that name, Prison Arts Collective, mm-hmm. and then it's come to define all of our work within the institution.
And that's great. Thank you. Cheryl, I wonder if you can talk a little bit about certainly about the work you do generally, but if you could speak more specifically to the value of educational programs and correctional facilities, and specifically arts, creative writing, the expressive types of education.
Sure. So I started this work about 16 years ago as a volunteer Catholic chaplain, working with children who are being tried as adults. So some of my kids have artwork on the walls here, and that's really where Andy and I connected in the work as well. So our organization works both with people in institutions, so children being tried as adults, and working with them in the juvenile hall, in the prison system, and because the reentry work really starts inside, and then we have a reentry organization that we work with them when they come home. And I think walking around and looking at the exhibit, you can't help but, and listening to what Andy was just saying, you can't help but understand the healing power of art when you know that everybody, teachers and students, are being affected, and then when you take that component of outside coming in, the community coming to people inside, and what happens in that connection between students and teachers, that everybody feels valued, and everybody feels, we feel connected. And for the teachers to be able to come in and make a connection with inmates inside, it's really important for guys inside that are doing 10 years or are lifers or are doing 35 years to feel connected to something in the community. So not only does this kind of work help them see their own value in being able to create something so incredible, you oftentimes see prison art, right? You see their tattoos and you see how they, that what people would call prison artwork. This is people understanding their artistic ability beyond what they even knew or what they were ever exposed to. So you just walk around these rooms, and I can't say enough about how grateful I am that we're bringing now and bringing that community into our community, and that connection is what's really powerful and important. And it changes people. You know, your transformation doesn't come from education and from that being isolated and that punishment piece. Your transformation comes from understanding your own inherent value in the world, and then understanding what happened when you made a great error that hurt another human being. I've never met a kid who's killed someone or who's committed a violent crime who valued their own life. So if we can help people understand their own inherent value, then all of a sudden I see the value of another human being. And that's what this kind of program really does for people.
Thanks, Andy. So that seems like a perfect segue, Heather. I wonder if you could, I think we could talk for a while, but maybe you could jump in at this point and talk a little bit about what you've learned in the process of working in this program.
Okay, so I'll just give a little bit more background. Initially, I started in a psychology program, and then I made my way to our program at Cal State San Bernardino, and I remember you coming to a presentation in the class, and I instantly connected to it. One, because most recently, besides my troubled past and knowing how we make mistakes, but I had been to jail a few times, and even though I didn't have to do long-term time, it was enough to just see the whole picture. this therapy, it's made me feel better, and I wanted to share that with them. That if they can't get out, that at least I can bring in, you know, that empathy and then give them that healing power of work. And talking about, you know, connecting them, like even bringing on the art and exposing them and showing it to other people, they feel valued and connected just by bringing the art to the person and like knowing that other people are still interacting with it.
Yeah, for you to say, that I'm going to take this piece of artwork that you did and I'm going to show it to as many people as I possibly can is like,
yeah.
So, yeah, beautiful.
I know we chill. Skill level. And then I also saw more like the tattoo art type of stuff. members and students and alumni at the time saying, hey, you know, what do we want to value what's here, but also open their minds to what else could be so they can make the choice. So it's not like we're saying, oh no, this other kind of art is better. It's just, we just start showing stuff. We just start bringing, like Heather was saying, like bringing in images, bringing in different types of art history. We include some element of art history in every single class that we teach. And then slowly we start to see shifts and transformations. Like in the room next to this, there's a lot of pieces specifically about the experience of incarceration. And we hadn't seen that ever until just over the past year. Actually, one of the artists, Chris Branscom, who's in prison in Lancaster, a California prison in Lancaster, was the first person who did something related to that. And another, Juan Carlos Tercero, he also did one in the last show. And then after that, it sort of opened the floodgates that more and more wanted to express that. But it's never like, oh, you have to make something about that. Because some people say, you know what, I'm here all the time. This is all I see. I really just want to create something beautiful to take me out of that. So what we wanted to do is just provide options and tools. And we have people who have never, ever made art before. And then we have people who have been training themselves to paint for the past 20 years. So we have a lot of variety. And I feel like it's all reflected in what we're showing here. So it's nice.
What's great is it seems like they thrive off of being able to self-express.
Yes.
And to find themselves in the art rather than just, you know, not painting.
Yeah, I think that's true. Because it isn't to say that it's bad or wrong, but it's just to say that they didn't know anything else. Mm-hmm. And so when you show, wow, look at what this artist did, and this one, then they go, oh, and then gradually they start to make it more about their experience, whether it's abstraction or whether it's realism. And like, if you look at the landscapes, you have to also remember they're not seeing that. So it could be from memory. You know, most of these are more from memory than from looking at images. So it's kind of interesting.
I was going to ask you about that because I think that's one thing that's amazing, that I've seen so much artwork from people where you can say, wait, you weren't looking out the window. You weren't sitting on the side of the road with an easel looking at it. That was in your head? Like, that picture was in your head? That's crazy to me. And I think the other thing that people don't realize is most inmates who are doing artwork in prison are using a pencil only. So color is like, I remember a kid who had come home and he took his first community college class in art and they gave him these colored pencils and he was like, oh, I've only worked in shades of gray because that's where I would have my color. And he kind of didn't know what to do with it. And I don't know how you guys experienced with that, with them experimenting with color.
With color?
Yeah.
I don't know. When I came in, they're kind of used
they
to
were,
it by now.
Yeah.
When we first started, they had, it was at Chino, and they had already had a very small little arts program. Stan had done through teaching his peers.
Yeah.
And he actually rallied the institution to bring an arts program, which is why they reached out to us at Kelsey San Bernardino. So it really did start from what they had. So they were doing painting. I don't know if they were able to get stuff sent in. But now
they're also not that out.
Yes.
Like when you were showing me with the coffee.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
It's like the coffee or where they, how they created pigments and colors out of things. It's just
like scraping off the scales and M&Ms. Yeah. It's really innovative. And so they want the art tool, so we bring that in, but we're also like, wow, you made that. Like, I remember some of our first teachers would be like, wait, that's your first painting? Like, you can teach me something, you know? And they're like studying art or received a degree in art from university, saying that to the incarcerated person, that's a value that they feel like, oh, I have that skill that I can, I have this technical skill. What do I want to do with that?
Yeah.
So I think it's these sort of just organic exchanges that, we have curriculum and we have these structured classes, but I think it's these exchanges that happen within that are what's so powerful.
Yeah.
Like someone going, hey, you know, you paint circles around me, and he's hearing that going, what? Because you're from New York City, you're saying that, you know? It shows them what they have to offer that's different from maybe what they thought that they had.
Yeah, and I think there's just that communication piece too is something different. Like one thing that I noticed when we do programs on the Alps, sorry.
It's like
the community.
Yeah.
That I recognize that when we have like a class that is reflective or about social issues or something, that we're inspiring them to have a conversation. conversation that they've never had, have a conversation in the level that they haven't had. So just that dialogue between teachers and students is engaging them in a kind of conversation that they're not having in a prison yard. Because in a prison yard, all they're talking about is survival, right? And so now they're engaging in something that is enlightening and is life-affirming and is on an intellectual level that I'm craving, but I can't find it anywhere, you know? Or I think even from a safety place, right? Heather, like not feeling comfortable having that conversation about maybe how a piece of art makes them feel, or what I'm getting out of this is sort of an emotional component that I can share with anybody, but
yeah,
I can share it in the space.
Which they're resistant at first, you know, but then when you build that trust and that relationship, and you really make them feel safe, and then they thrive off of that, and then they let themselves out. And then just grow and shine bright.
And so true. And it's like we do this thing where we ask them, well, what do you think creates a safe environment for art? And we record all their responses. So a boy from here to Calpetra, which is near the border of Mexico, where we're teaching a facilitator training. And last week was the first week, so we always do it on the first day. So we did that, we recorded everything, and then after, you know, they always talk about a space where it's not judgmental. Like that's almost the first thing they say. And then, you know, I always thought they'd say like, oh, big lights or like lots of materials. And sometimes they say that, but really it's more that emotional space. Yeah, that's what they comment on. And then we record all of these things, and then we pass out our participant guidelines and we ask them, you know, can you read it? Can you say if you agree? And I always say, look, you'll notice it's almost the same as the list because it always is. And we give them a chance, hey, if you disagree, cross something out, we can accept changes. And then this one guy came up to me after, he goes, that was really interesting. I saw that. Like, you were asking us all that, and we read these, and I go, oh, I see what they're doing. That's so cool. Like, it came from us. And I'm like, yeah. And I think it's a teacher training, so they're looking at it from that direction, but I just thought it was so interesting that not only did he appreciate it, but kind of noticed it as, like, a technique that he might use when he teaches. And I think for this particular project with facilitator training, it's especially interesting because for them to, it's one thing for us to come in from the outside and co-create this supportive, nurturing environment to talk about their art and art history, but then for them to do that for one another, I think it's very powerful. And our first one that already they're teaching their own classes is in Ireland, so about 45 minutes from here. And they're doing an amazing job, you know, and they really respect one another as the facilitators. This one older gentleman was learning guitar for the first time. His teacher was this young guy, and he walked by and the teacher wasn't there yet. And he looked a little frazzled. I'm like, oh, can I help you? He's like, well, I just saw my facilitator in that room and I don't know if he's coming to talk. Like, you know, and he didn't ask me, oh, can, are you gonna be here? This, he just was like looking for his facilitator. I was like, beautiful. I'm like, oh, he'll be right there. So, and you just went right in the class. So I think it's really exciting to see that.
I just wanted to add, as you were talking, just how important it is that they're not used to having a voice. And we give them that voice. And that's important to think about when we talk about how we give them a chance to say what they want, what they need, so that their voice matters.
Do you find, but in the same way with the emotional component, do you find that takes some time?
So yes.
You, like, there's a question, like, you really want to hear what I have to say? And then, what do I want
to
say?
Because they're right? So used to being told what to do, you know, and they don't really have that chance.
Right. And what do I think?
Yeah. Which is, I relate to that, too, just in my upbringing, you know, I wasn't used to having that voice. And so I really connect with these women. I mean, well, I haven't been able to really work with women yet, but I think it's really important that they have a voice and that they're heard.
It's true that you see a change, like the highest security prison where we teach in Lancaster and Calpetra, they're level 4. And that's where I saw the biggest change, because the first, not at A yard, but in the other yards, the first day we went there, like, looking at the floor, and like, very, like, oh, you could, like, cut the tension with a knife. They were very stressed. Yeah. And we come in, and we talk about the program, and we ask them, we always ask, we at least give some choice. So if it's our first time teaching there, you know, we haven't necessarily been able to create a program specific to them, but we'll give them at least a choice of like these two two or three classes, and even just choosing a class, they were like, and then someone from the prison was like, well, we'll just put them in class. So it's like, well, let's see if they want to choose, you know, because at least give them, and if they're more comfortable just being placed in the class, fine, but at least just that one option of if choosing, you know, drawing or 3D sculpture or whatever the choices were that day. So, and it changed so much, because if you see the photos in this exhibition were taken by Peter Wirtz, who does our photography for art collections, and he's mentored to some of our team, and he's a friend of everyone doing this work and us as well. And anyway, you'll see in the next room some pictures from Lancaster that were taken like 2 years after we started, and they're big smiles and like making these fun collages and laughing and smiling, and you just see, wow, that is a really big transformation.
Yeah, and that feeds into reentry, because some of the biggest things that people experience when in coming home is that first trip to Starbucks or that first trip to a restaurant where it's like, there's too many choices, right? So helping people, you know, yes, it's therapeutic, yes, it's emotionally empowering, yes, it's transformative, but it's also still part of that reentry, that tangible hard skills reentry process before they come home, is being able to think like that, being able to think for myself.
You know? I wanted to ask, can I?
Please.
It kind of goes back, and I think you're right, because you're talking about the reentry. I'm sort of curious when you're talking about the not being able to look out the window and see that. And so I was curious because there's, you know, I feel like you draw these things all the time about when prisoners come out and they don't know what a cell phone is. And, you know, so there's like you were just saying, Starbucks. And I was just curious that whole, you made me think about this idea of the visual sort of deprivation almost, like, and coming out, that there is this almost like this weird like visual culture deficit or something, you know? And
definitely visual deprivation. There is this, like, if you think about a kid that went into prison at 15 and he comes out at 30, what my son, who is 18 now, experienced in the last 5 years of his life as a teenager, talking to coaches, talking to teachers, talking to girls, talking to guys, all of those thousands of experiences that he's had. My kid who's been, I call them all my kids, my kid who's been in prison since he was 15 hasn't had those. So he comes out and has a relationship with a girl, and she breaks up with him, and he responds at 30 like he's 18, and he's been broken up with for the first time, and he grows a beard, and he gets all solid, and I'm like, oh my God, Maria, I'm 18, you don't know how to do this, right? And so we can never fill the gap of all those years, but it's also recognizing that there are those deprivations that we can't fill. We can just do the best we can to kind of pick up where we are. Or even, like I have a staff member who's an incredible artist, I say. Mm-hmm. He used to ride the bus to work, and he would sit on the bus, and he was convinced that everybody on the bus knew he just came home from prison. But he's sitting there in a shirt and tie on his way to work, and he just thought, for sure they know I just got out, for sure they know how long I was down, for sure they know what I did. Like, he was so self-conscious, and then a couple weeks later he realized, they don't give a crap about me. They're actually in their own world, they don't even know I'm on the bus. And so it took him a while, just like, he was so nervous getting on the bus because he thought he just stood out.
Because it's like an issue of presentation.
Yeah.
We're talking about representation.
And
then it goes to present, you know, he feels like he's being represented in the world without control.
Yep.
You know, and so it's like he needs to learn this lesson, right? That he can control representation, you know, and it's always that struggle of how individuals are represented in society, particularly through visual culture.
Yeah.
That reminds me of, so in the first room, there's the installation, and that was a project that we worked on this summer, and I actually led it. It was a collaborative multidisciplinary workshop, and I had a guest artist, Fung, worked on it with me, and several of our in schools, you know, stuff like that. But what they ended up settling on, obviously completely independently at both sites, was the representation of people who are incarcerated. So it was really interesting that that's what they wanted to show, and that we're people too, and we have lives and family and cares. And so they both did it in very different ways, but I thought the projects that both of the groups of artists came up with were so incredible, and then we just got to kind of help guide it along the way. And one of them, if you see in the video, the men, they made placards, and it was the same color as the uniform. So what you're saying about representation reminded me, so it's blue with yellow words. And so they were talking, and one of them jumped up and he said, "Wait a sec." And you turn around, and it says on the back, CDCR prisoner. And you turn around and he goes, "Okay, read this. What does it say?" And he's like, "Wait, it says it already. We can use that." So then they stood up to the back of the camera showing that and spun around and showed the placards, which says whatever they chose to write, peer, human, brother, father. And then they flipped it around and it showed whatever they wanted to represent themselves, which was much more kind of unique, like someone was a papa, So I think that it just reminded me of that issue of like representation and presentation and like claiming a voice for yourself even within this environment that is very well institutional.
When you were talking about humanity or giving them a voice, what made me think of was this gives them hope as well as humanity. It's a reason that they go to bed at night rather than thinking about surviving the next day. But, gee, what am I going to create the next day? Or how can I do this? Or how can I do that? Rather than what they have normally experienced, just surviving. So even for those that are long-term, it's still a reason to get up the next morning.
That is hopeful. And you're right that hope is the first move towards transformation. If I have no hope, what am I gonna, like, why am I going to be different? Who cares? Nobody cares about me. So why do I, if I have nothing, I'm not coming, I'm not going home, I'm not whatever. But yeah, that is that hope and sense of value.
Okay. The prison environments that you work in, are most of them, how many are long-term? How many are, long-term versus I'm going to be out 5 years or whatever?
So we work in seven currently, and it's all different, but for the most part, in prison versus jail, they are longer sentences. We definitely work with some who are lifers, some life without parole, so they're not going to be getting out. And then some, there's one particular one, CRC in Norco, where they seem to be shorter sentences. But I will say that about 5 years that we've been doing this, and in the last like 6 months, more of the individuals that we work with have gotten out than ever.
Is that about 47?
No, it's actually, it's a series of bills. And it's a series of bills that have changed sentencing laws for kids being tried as adults primarily. So SB 9, SB 260, SB 261 are all bills that were passed that affect more than 20,000 inmates that were sentenced. SB 9 is about juvenile life without parole. So in California, we can sentence a 14-year-old to life in prison without ever coming home. SB 9 changed that, so anybody with juvenile LR can go back to their sentencing judge and request a resentencing, and the best deal they can get is 25 to life, which just means instead of never coming out, at 25 years, you can begin to earn your way out. It's not a guarantee that you can earn your way out. SB 260 was changing sentencing laws for kids convicted under the age of 18, that either kid that was given 120 years and 6 months might as well have been life without parole. 120 years for 6 months, he was not the shooter, and he died, and he was permanently injured. He was 15. And so SB 260 changes those sentencing laws where the parole board not only has to lower his sentence, but they have to take into consideration brain science around the development of the brain. So it's really, so these kids that are coming home are really coming home on a lot of laws,
because what I hear is you have experience with people at the jail, but that's what we want to prevent to the kids when they grow up, or even just say 40, 50, they could be, I mean, that's what we're trying to prevent. They have a good, this school plan in the, I'm yes. sorry for my English.
Yes.
During the school, because they have a lot of fights, or even with the teachers, the punishment too much for them. And they, you know, if they do something like simple things, they send to the office or they send to home. And that simple things could be accumulated, and then at the end, expelled from the school. And that affects the kids because, well, you know everything. Well, the reason why I explain is because I want to ask you for your support, or if you have any recommendation for us, because we have a little bit of trouble with the CSUSB, the board, to accept the referral to justice at the school. I mean, where we are focused right now is in the middle school.
Yes.
Because, you know, it's the age when they are not there anymore, or they are not 18, and they still, this is a chance, is that time for them to try, they are trying to look for their own identity, or they didn't know where they wanted, so that's where we are focused right now in the middle school. I don't know if you want, I mean, if you have any suggestion for us or any recommendation. And the other thing is, what I am doing this is because I have four boys, they are okay right now, but I'm thinking about the other kids who are in trouble, or they are not in school anymore. There are too many, because I know that referrals to justice it prevent that suicide. That, yeah, so I know what is the benefit to have a referral to justice at the school level? I mean, it's really what we're looking for, to try to implement the referral to justice in the school. And I hear you have a lot of experience, and I don't know if you have any suggestions or recommendations for us, please.
Can I just say thank you so much for being here. I've read some about the work that you've been doing, you and others, with Bobby Duke School,
oh,
right?
You know,
yes.
Awesome.
One of the reasons that I wanted to bring this exhibit here and bring the teachers and educators here is because I think there's so much opportunity to try to interrupt that school to prison pipeline. Kind of cool to hear about that. Are there other questions from the audience?
Lisa, hold on, because what you just did and what you just said about the CO having a response to it, that's a really interesting point, because I think sometimes I don't ever expect people to buy into this work the way I do, because I just have a compassion and love for these people. And I recognize that it's a complex conversation, and it's and there are always survivors, and there are always people on the other end of why that person is in prison. But I think when you look at the value of arts programs and things that can help people transform, it actually makes life better for everybody inside. Because prison is not a place for anybody, not to work, not to live, not to anything. It is not a healthy environment for anybody who goes there, and you see that in suicide rates, and divorce rates, and alcoholism rates, and in people who work inside. So it's unhealthy all the way around. So to kind of help people understand the value for everybody in someone feeling like they don't want to get in a fight, or they don't want to make a shame, or they don't want to whatever, is it values everybody.
Yeah.
You bring up an interesting point.
I'm sorry. There was a question in the back. Andrea?
Thank you.
methodology of, yeah. That's an interesting question. I definitely get feedback from the participants and from our teaching artists, and I kind of just hear the kinds of things that people are saying. Like, I've heard them say, you know, you bring the humanity, we feel more human, we feel value, we have hope. Like, the kinds of things we're saying, they say that, like, when they write their post surveys and stuff like that. And in terms of, like, my colleagues and our teaching artists, I think that I see young people who are college students, who most of our students are first-generation college students, and many of them come from the same communities where we're teaching, oh, pretty much the vast majority. Some have family members who are incarcerated, some have family members who are correctional officers, some whose parents said, oh my gosh, you are not going inside a prison, and they stood up and said, no, I believe in this, I want to do this. So they are, I see them becoming empowered because of the methodology where it's like not just me saying, here's what you have to teach, but it's like, well, okay, you're studying painting, well, how might you make that into a class, and how can you help out here? And so I guess I see it almost there, and I just kind of see them evolve into these really, like, strong teachers, and it's really beautiful.
But what do you have anything to add? I don't know. Does that make sense?
I know it's hard.
Most of whom are first-generation college students.
70% of our students identify as Hispanic, and an even higher number are low socioeconomic status, so all the government language in terms of how we talk about populations, it's been so powerful, and it's so refreshing because oftentimes there's a lot of art in the Coachella Valley, art is even on TV now, right, and there are reality shows about making art or becoming an artist, and that's not bad, but I think it's so valuable to be able to show art, as Andrea was asking about, to show art that comes from people who are not celebrities, that provides a different type of, a different point of connection, because most of us don't deal with celebrities in our everyday lives.
That art is just universal, and it's for everybody, and it's very personal, and it's about telling your stories and healing.
Yeah, that's real, yes. Heather was just commenting on that, yeah, that it's, you know, that art is universal, and it is about and for everyone, and that it's healing, so absolutely, yeah.
It feels like there's a big disconnect between art making and art marketing, mm-hmm. and it's like the two worlds seem very different, like you and I, we want to make a world where people are making art, and a lot of other people seem much more focused on making money off of art. World seen it for they seem to be really big takeovers.
Yeah. And you know, this morning I happened to run into a student who had taken art appreciation with me some years back. We hadn't seen each other in a while, and it was really nice, and she I told her, I said, you know, well, if you're on campus, why don't you come by this afternoon? Shout out to Sandra. She I don't know that I knew this or fully recognized it, but she shared with me this morning that she had been in prison, that art and learning about art and making art in our class was so powerful for her. It was really healing. So again, I think that's part of what made me motivated to try to bring this here, because I see that happening in our classrooms, and as I said, so many of our students have connections, for better or worse, with the correctional system in one way or another. May have family members or friends on the inside, may also have family member and friends who are also correction officers, because that's one of the few job growth areas out here in the desert, besides hospitality, corrections, and public safety. So it's really nice to be able to make those connections.
Just wanted to ask one thing. It goes back, sort of circles back to what you just mentioned. And it was great to mention the correction officer. And I was just curious, like, it goes back to your comment about how prisons are not good for anyone. And if there is an element where the officers are involved in your program, somehow, maybe, you know, in some way,
so,
if you think about that.
Yeah, they are, because since we started, because now we have staff and different levels of people, like people involved who are staff and not only college students. But when we first started, it was only college students teaching, and so I wanted it to be with the correctional officer in the room, because I had never been inside a prison, and it seemed wise to have that happen. And we've just kind of retained that, and because we just teach in spaces where there's already an officer there, like in the gym. But in the end, what happened, which was really cool, is they kind of become part of our program. Like, they're like one of them, Officer Ward from CIA, he's like one of us. Like, we gave him an award recently to thank him for, you know, all his work with our program, and he was just like, he couldn't believe it, like, what, you're watching me? I was like, yes, because you're seeing the value in this. And once I said to him, Ward, you know, why don't you participate? You could take one of the classes. And he goes, you know what, Annie, I am participating in the way that the role I'm playing, which is just watching out for everything and all of you guys, and I'm just kind of checking to be sure everything's safe, and that's my way of being part of our program. And I was like, okay, that's solid, I totally get that, you know? And so I think that's important. That said, it could be classes for officers or even for like officers and
takeaway? Would any of you have something to add before we wrap up?
It's funny because I was going to ask Andy. when you, what do you want people to walk away from when they see this, when they know, when you bring your students to the side, when you bring this out, what do you want people to walk away from? You hope.
I hope that you have. I don't know if this is sufficient.
I just want to say that I feel like the institutions are working at the heart of the problem, and I feel like we are doing that a little bit at a time every day, working at the heart of the problem, and we are activists, and we're promoting positive change.
Yes.
No, it is.
Tonight, so the gallery is open till 7. One of our students will be playing.